So today's lecture is the regulation of blood flow. And so the first notes here get us ready for what I'm going to talk about today and tomorrow, and also review a little bit of what we discussed yesterday. The bottom line, as a student of physiology, do you know how the body regulates blood pressure? I say arterial BP and not flow is sensed and regulated to maintain blood flow to the heart and brain. So that first sentence, let's break that down. The heart and brain, your most vital organs, and cardiovascular system is equipped to make sure those organs always get their blood by having enough blood pressure to push blood to those organs. So the thing how the body regulates it is you have to be able to sense a homeostatic imbalance. Either blood's not flowing or pressure is dropping. Now, the body has no mechanism to sense blood flow, but it can detect changes in arterial pressure. Okay, so that's the first thing I'm telling you. Body can detect a drop in pressure, but not flow. Right. The second thing here is regulation of arterial BP occurs by altering blood volume in the arteries. So the idea is, if arteries are losing blood, arterial pressure drops, okay? And that's not too hard to understand. The thing is, what we said yesterday is that arteries carry small volumes of blood, which are large for its capacitance. So we observe high pressures. Remember that whole CVP thing? Capacitance, volume, bring it back. Okay, so to review again, they don't carry a lot of blood, but they're full. They can't carry any more, okay? So for arteries, the capacitance is fixed. They carry all they can carry, and that's it. It's fixed. It can't change. That's not the case for veins, is it? They have a much larger capacitance. You can vary that, but not for arteries, okay? They're always at their max capacity. So therefore, pressure is solely a function of the volume residing in the artery at the time pressure is measured. So whenever I read this, I think of like the nurses running around taking vital signs, or maybe just you set the machine to do it every 30 minutes. But why do you have to keep doing that? Because of this. It's like if the blood pressure changes, you're indirectly measuring how much blood is in the arteries. So if that is changing, you need to know, okay, something's going wrong. That's why you have to keep measuring blood pressure. And when we do our BP lab tomorrow, I mean, we even have students take blood pressure readings every minute. I'm just curious, does anyone have experience taking blood pressure readings with a BP cuff? Okay, good. In a class like this, we usually have people with experience, and it's been years since my intern days, and they're probably better than me. But it's always good to have someone in your group. And when we do our BP lab, if you want to kind of check yourself because you're new, you haven't done it before, check against someone who has experience doing it. That's good practice for you in a lab setting. But to make sure we're all on the same page, I'll make sure everyone knows how to take a proper BP reading. So which reminds me, for tomorrow's lab, two things. Print it out and bring that exercise mat again. There is a procedure where the subject will lie down and stand up again. So work that out. That's tomorrow's lab. Print it out. It's called BP lab. Someone come ready to exercise. Okay. All right, so I'll more on that later. To get back to this, so now you know why you have to like keep measuring blood pressure in clinical settings. You're measuring how much volume of blood is in the arteries. Oh, so that kind of ties into this statement. Mean arterial pressure, MAP, is maintained by controlling the inflow and outflow of blood in systemic arteries. Now, we use those terms in cardiac cycle, but this chapter isn't the cardiac cycle, is it? This is blood vessels. And so now, when we use the terms inflow and outflow, it's within reference to the arteries, the systemic arteries. So I found this picture, it kind of like summarizes it nicely. I like what it shows. One is, it shows the cardiovascular system as a true circulatory system with the heart circulating the blood here. They show blue veins, red arteries. And why is the tube much bigger for veins? It's because they're large capacitance, right? Small fixed capacitance. And here's the CVP thing, okay? And we're not gonna really plug and chug numbers, but we did talk about it conceptually. Let me briefly show that to you, that you at least understand it in concept. C, capacitance, volume, pressure. Okay, so for arteries, do they carry large or small volumes of blood?
Small.
So imagine putting a small number in the numerator. What kind of pressures did we observe in arteries, high or low?
High.
High. So imagine a small number divided by a large number. What kind of number does that give you? Divide a small number by a large number gives you a very small number. So we say for arteries, the capacitance is small. That's what I've been saying, right? Okay, let's do the same thing for veins. For volume, do veins carry large or small volumes?
Large.
A big number up here. Now what kind of pressures do we observe in veins? Small. Low pressures. So imagine dividing a large number by a small number gives you a very large capacitance. Okay, so that's all that is. So we did talk about that. For arteries, capacitance is small, the capacitance is fixed. Okay? Therefore, arterial pressure is controlled mostly by controlling inflow and outflow. That's how you control the volume there. So for us, our inflow is cardiac output, right? 5 liters a minute in the condition of rest. Right there, that's our inflow. So our outflow is controlled by the peripheral resistance. Let me clear the board here. Alright, so in this chapter, inflow, it's going to be cardiac output. And we know cardiac output is a product of two things. Heart rate times stroke volume. Okay, so for us, that's the inflow. So the outflow, peripheral resistance. Sometimes I'll just say PR or just R as an abbreviation for resistance. If I just say resistance, it's understood peripheral resistance. And let's remember the names of the smallest arteries right before capillaries. They're called arterioles. And we said they're very good at vasoconstriction. So that is really the control of peripheral resistance, the outflow. They control it. Vasoconstriction of arterioles. You know, there are conditions where maybe you have brainstem trauma. You mess up the sympathetic efferents that control the arterioles, and they just dilate. If they dilate and the outflow just gets too high, what's going to happen to all the blood here? It's just going to get pushed into this big balloon. Blood will pull in the veins away from the vital organs, and that shock could lead to death. Have you lost any blood? Not a drop, but it's still shock. Shock is still a lack of blood flow. I mean, the most common shock is you get shot or stabbed and you're losing blood, but it can happen just by whatever reason. You can't vasoconstrict, so all the blood just leaves the arteries. So outflow is important. Okay. So, blood flow is determined by cardiac output. Already got that. Now, sometimes in physics, flow is symbolized by F. So if you see the term in your studies, flow is F, flow of a liquid. I mean, you study in the basic college physics class, you know, you talk about Poiseuille's law. I won't mention that, but that's where the F is coming from in my lecture. And in terms of a blood vessel chapter, just think of flow as cardiac output. Okay, so in your head, just think that. It's cardiac output. That's the concept. Blood flow is determined by cardiac output. Now, the other thing is blood, enclosed blood, exerts a force or pressure on the vessel wall. And we studied the vessel wall the last time. You remember the three tunics, TI, TM, TA, that vessel wall, those three layers. And here's a picture of different kinds of pressure that we should consider. I'll define three kinds of blood pressure. Hydrostatic pressure. So what they do in their example, they have a leg blood vessel, maybe it's an artery in the leg, and it's at some 45 random degree angle. So that if you're not horizontal, but you're at some plane of vertical, consider the distance between H1 and H2. Let me say this, whenever you talk about pressure, you're always talking about a pressure gradient, a pressure difference between two locations. That's how I want you to think about pressure. Always consider a pressure gradient between two locations. So in the case of hydrostatic pressure, it's in the vertical plane, the difference between H1 and H2. So basically we say it's going to be the pressure against gravity, right? Important to consider because we walk upright, we're bipeds. So my foot's down there, but I gotta get the blood up to my heart. My head's up here, but my heart's in my chest, so I gotta get blood from my heart up to my head. Okay, now this doesn't come up too much. A few times it comes up, like when I was a student, they would talk about fighter pilots and how when they had to fly jets, if the jet just veer down a little bit, the g-force down is so great, the heart is not strong enough to pump blood to the head and the pilots black out. I remember watching all these simulation videos of pilots in the flight simulator, and they just got it's just a headshot of the pilot, and you just see him black out. It's pretty amazing. Now, in the case where you'll experience hydrostatic pressure, there's a part of the lab where you're asked to lie down, relax. You're horizontal, so there's no hydrostatic pressure. Everything kind of vasodilates. When you stand up, again, you feel that little faintness where blood rushes down. That's hydrostatic pressure taking effect. All the blood is kind of leaving this area. And what did you observe in the heart rate after your subject sat up? Did it go up or down? It should have went up. Okay, that's the reflex. So that's kind of another effect where you can kind of like play around with it. Yeah.
While you're
relaxed, that's why it goes down. Yeah. But when you stand up, you trigger a reflex. And that's called, I want you to remember this term, for lecture exam four, orthostatic hypotension. We have you do it by having the subject lie down and then stand up. I think in your lab you just sat up, but I think for the BP lab, I think you have more of an effect if you stand up. You know, the traditional way you do this, you have this tilt table where you're kind of like lying on a tilt, and then the subject doesn't have to do anything. Someone just kind of like takes the whole table and shifts you upright. You're just kind of sitting there like that. But we don't have those, obviously. So we ask you to lie down and then stand up. But it's to elicit this effect, this brief drop in blood pressure. Lie down, relax, okay, and then stand. Trigger a reflex due to a drop in blood pressure. I mean, your blood isn't going anywhere. It's just you're tricking your body. Like the blood, just for a split second, is kind of like going down. But the thing is, you don't know this yet. The pressure sensors that pick up if there's a change in blood pressure are here in the carotid artery and the aortic arch. They're up here. So when blood goes down, it's like, hey, right here, it's like, where's the blood? And it triggers a reflex to increase the heart rate. So you'll see that. So anyway, that's where hydrostatic pressure comes in, force against gravity. Okay, let me define transmural pressure. So look here. They zoom in across the vessel wall. Here's our three tunics. And imagine there's blood here pushing against the vessel wall. There's going to be a pressure difference between the point inside and outside the vessel wall. Okay, so here it's R1 and R2. Transmural pressure. Again, consider the pressure gradient across two points. So in this case, transmural pressure is the pressure difference across the vessel wall. Said, you have baroreceptors, pressure sensors in the carotid sinus. That's the exact place where you take your carotid pulse. What's a mural? You need something to hang on the wall. So transmural means across the vessel wall. Now this pressure is important because this is the one your body can detect. Receptors in the carotid sinus and aortic arch. Lie in the vessel wall. Therefore, your body can detect changes in transmural pressure. Changes I abbreviated PTRANS, capital P pressure trans, my abbreviation for transmural pressure. So imagine a nerve ending right inside the vessel wall there. If you're losing blood in this vessel, there's going to be a change in pressure. It's going to be a pressure drop. Okay, and the nerve ending in there will pick up on it. and send a signal to the brain to do the right reflex, and we'll talk about that. That's tomorrow's lecture. Or the opposite, blood pressure is getting too high, and you stretch this too much. You should have the opposite reflex. So we'll talk about that. Okay, that's why you can detect it. The nerve endings are in the vessel wall. Okay. Okay, the third kind of pressure is the pressure, driving pressure. We call it driving pressure because by definition it's along the axis of a vessel. Okay, so it's driving the blood to the capillaries. So I think that's on my next slide too. Advance the slide. Flow of blood between two points along a tube depends on a change in pressure. A change in pressure, the pressure gradient, not absolute pressure. Okay, that's the point I wanted to make. Pressure gradient along the axis of a blood vessel. What I say in the slide is what matters is not the absolute pressure, but the pressure gradient, the difference between two points. Okay? And so, what I mean by that, I give some examples. This delta P, a change in pressure. Delta is the triangle in Greek letters, but it always means change in science. Let's look at this example. Example A, example B. Pretend there are blood vessels with blood flow in it, and assume everything else is equal, except look at the change here. We have two points, this side of the tube and that side of the tube, 90-10, 175. So then I ask the question, I'll ask you, which one will have a greater flow rate of the liquid based on what I just told you? A or B?
B.
It is A. See, let me think how you're thinking. Some students might think it's B because, look, 100's higher than 90. But consider the other end, it's 75. So what's the gradient between 100 and 75? 25, okay, so 25. What's the gradient from between 90 and 80? I'm saying 90 and 10,
80.
So if the gradient is 80, but the gradient is 25, physics says this will have a greater flow rate. So it's the gradient, not the higher number, okay? That's Poiseuille's law. That's the only thing I really need you to understand here. Okay, so I asked the question here. What cardiovascular structure generates this blood pressure gradient in systemic circulation? I showed you this figure again. What's the peak pressure the left ventricle generates? 120. It's the left ventricle. That's it. So in the cardiovascular system, it's the muscular pump, the left ventricle. LV generates 120 millimeters of mercury pressure. So when you measure a person's mean arterial blood pressure or just blood pressure, what are you measuring? The high end or the low end? The high end. And what you say is, okay, there's enough of a, if blood pressure is normal, you're saying, okay, there's enough volume of blood in the arteries, and there's enough pressure to drive that blood to the capillaries. That's what you're saying. And if the arterial pressure drops, what you think is, the arteries are losing blood, and there may not be enough pressure to sustain blood flow to the capillaries. So you have to start to think that way, if you're not thinking that way already, about why you measure BP. It's all about pushing blood to the capillaries. That's why you circulate it. Okay, next slide. So any questions on the three types of blood pressure? Hydrostatic, transmural, the striving pressure. They're all important for different reasons. Okay, let me talk about the outflow a little more, this peripheral resistance. What factors affect resistance to blood flow? Now you need, it's kind of like peripheral resistance is good and bad. You need peripheral resistance. Otherwise, like I said earlier, all the blood leaves the arteries and that's a form of shock. But you don't want too much resistance to blood flow or blood won't flow. Okay, so it's this delicate balance. I'm just gonna go through the determinants of peripheral resistance. Resistance is, just like the word would imply, anything that opposes blood flow. Resistance, anything that opposes blood flow. Now the number one thing that opposes blood flow, that I don't even have here, is the friction of blood rubbing against the vessel wall. Okay, but that's a constant. I'll write it up here anyways. Friction of blood against which tunic is touching the blood?
TI.
And what part of TI is actually touching the blood? The endothelium, right? So that's what I'm talking about here. But you know, you have to have a blood vessel. You can't just have blood hanging in space. You know, it's flowing through your tubes, so it's a given. And so, but these determinants can be modified a little bit. So let's talk about each of those, blood viscosity. Now, blood viscosity is pretty much like, you know, the goopiness of blood for any fluid. For example, water would flow a lot better than maple syrup. Would you agree? Because it's less viscous. So that's what I'm talking about. I would say the number one determinant of blood viscosity is the crit, the hematocrit, all the blood cells. We say crit for short. The blood's oxygen carrying capacity. On average, your blood is a little less than half crit. And it doesn't change in adults. Whatever your blood value is for hematocrit as an adult, it's pretty constant throughout your adulthood. So it's a constant. I'm not really gonna mention it much more. We don't kind of talk about things that just kind of stay the same. Okay, vessel length. But okay, before I move on to the next one, let me say this. If you increase blood viscosity, you increase resistance to blood flow. Okay, that's the rule. But it stays pretty constant. So what we say for vessel length is, all things being equal, if you have a blood vessel that's longer, the longer blood vessel gives more resistance simply because it's longer. Okay, so that's the rule. If you increase length, increase resistance. Capital R resistance. However, in adults, when you stop growing, that's constant, that doesn't change. I guess it could change if you put on a lot of weight, say 10 or 20 pounds of fat or muscle, depending on what you're doing. All that that extra tissue needs more blood vessels. And that could increase the peripheral resistance. But outside of large weight gains or losses, this is pretty constant in adults. Okay, turbulent blood flow. Turbulence. If you have a tube, people who study fluid flow in physics, they like laminar flow, so they draw all these like aerodynamic lines, nice and smooth. Laminar flow. That's ideal to decrease resistance to blood flow. But turbulence is, say, in a blood vessel. What if you have like a little plaque that intrudes on the lumen space? So that the blood that kind of flow has to flow around that, it's all messed up. Okay? Or there's a branch. And your arteries branch, that's unavoidable. But where an artery branches, the branch point is going to create turbulence. And that will increase resistance, and that's something your body has to overcome. But all of these conditions are more or less constant. They don't change very much. The thing that changes the most is the last one, and that's the one you have to understand the most. It has the greatest effect on peripheral resistance. Really, all this other stuff, almost cross it out in your notes. I have to mention it, but this is the one you understand. If you don't understand any of these, I really don't care. This is the one you need to know. This is how you modify peripheral resistance the most. The vasoconstriction. Now, the vasoconstriction, I'll start with the vasoconstriction of arterioles. Resistance is proportional to the radius. So I use a capital R for resistance. Whenever I use a lowercase r, it means something completely different. The radius of the diameter, the radius of the blood vessel. So this is my lumen. You know, radius is half the diameter, right? Changing the caliber, the radius of the lumen has the most effect. It's proportional to resistance to the fourth power. And so what that means, to the fourth power means, you change the vessel radius a little bit, you change the resistance a lot. A small change in little r can have a large change in capital R. To the fourth power. Let me show you a picture of that. Arterioles increase BP. Here's how it works. Maybe you're more or less dilated here. This is kind of the default. You know, you're relaxed. You're just sitting here listening to me talk. As relaxing as that can be. We say parasympathetic on. Okay. And how it works is you always have some sympathetic tone on your arteries. It's just like a volume knob, loud or soft. Usually it's kind of like on a low volume, because this is on and you're always blocking the sympathetic. So what I'm writing is parasympathetics, they inhibit the sympathetic. inhibit what we call sympathetic tone. Parasympathetic nerves don't directly innervate the tunica media, okay? But they can inhibit in the central nervous system. The parasympathetics can inhibit the sympathetic efferents. All right. So the effect of inhibiting sympathetics is to vasodilate, and that'll help drop BP a little bit. I'll put VD for vasodilate, down arrow BP, just for shorthand. Then let's say you turn the parasympathetic off. You're removing the sympathetic block. That allows the nerve to fire more, the sympathetic nerve to fire more. You get vasoconstriction. Turn. Parasympathetic off. Therefore, you're removing the sympathetic block. What you see there is the sympathetic nerve fires, you know, more catecholamines, and it makes the vessel constrict. So I'll put vasoconstriction leads to an increase in blood pressure. So that's the physiology. So can you intuitively see how a smaller lumen size increases the resistance for blood to flow? Now this is happening at the arterial. So that means you're able to keep more blood in the arteries, and that will, you should observe an increase in blood pressure systemically. Okay, so, I mean, how do you do this, say, in the lab? What's a sympathetic response? It's the fight or flight response, so some remarkable stress, and the question becomes, well, how the heck do we do it safely in a lab environment? It's called the cold pressure test, where your subject, I gotta warn you, it's very painful. Pain is a good elicitor of a sympathetic response, okay? We call it a noxious stimuli, painful. And so the way we safely do it is the subject will immerse their hand in the slushy ice water. And that sounds refreshing, maybe for like 2 seconds. And then it becomes extremely painful. And you're asked to do it for 3 minutes, and we never force you to do it as long as you can tolerate it. So I don't want anyone passing out or vomiting. That's almost happened. That hasn't happened yet. So be prepared to subject yourself to pain. It is painful. I just got to warn you. But that's how we do this. We want to elicit a sympathetic response. So tomorrow, whatever hand is submerged, put the BP cup on the other arm. It doesn't have to be the same arm, right? It's a systemic response. So you should observe an increase in blood pressure, I would say after the first or second minute. You might have to nurse them a little bit if they hold out for the 3 minutes. Okay. But I think some of you guys are pre-nursing, so it should be a practice for you. All right, so if you excite the SNS, that's sympathetic nervous system, what is the effect on tunica media and blood pressure? So here's how I want you to think. I'm trying to train your brain. I'm programming you, right? Okay, choose this one or two, and then choose one of these. Choose one of these, choose one of these. Which one of these would you choose? You would constrict. The arterioles. You can now choose one of these.
Increase.
So think about it in that order. This causes that. Okay, that's why I want you to think about the physiology of that. So let's do the other scenario. Okay, you turn parasympathetic nerves on. Turn on parasympathetic nerves. What is the effect on tunica media and blood pressure? Okay, so if you turn on parasympathetic, which happens? One or two? You inhibit the sympathetic. As a result of that, what happens? You vasodilate and then drop BP. So that's kind of the way you have to think about it. So here's a picture of a hypothetical blood vessel, and look at the center axis, R, radius. Imagine all the blood flowing in this tube, put them in shells or layers. Okay, this is the best layer in terms of velocity of blood flow. Okay, that's what that means. Along the central axis, velocity is maximal, Vmax. But look, as you get progressively closer to layer zero, which is the actual vessel wall, layer one has the slowest velocity because it has the most friction. Okay, so you know, if you have laminar blood flow, the blood flow is the best at these center layers. So that's why vasoconstriction has increased resistance, because you have less of those laminar flow layers that are far away from the vessel wall. The whole thing's constricted. Here in the vasodilation, I guess you have more layers that have better laminar flow, because they're you have more layers further away that are from the vessel wall. So to really nail it down, I mean, I got this from a physics textbook. If you just did the math and calculated, here radius is 5 millimeters, and the flow rate, 10 mils per second. Here they reduce it to 4.2, and the flow is reduced to 5. So what I'm trying to press upon you is, you've reduced the vessel radius by 16%, and you've decreased the flow by half. So it has a very large effect on blood flow. Okay. So going back to the human body, you have to think about this arteriolar constriction in two ways, locally and systemically. Now, when you do the cold pressor test, that's systemic, okay? Pain in the whole organism. I have to do something now for the whole body. But this is always happening, this kind of dilation, constriction. It's always happening at a local level for every tissue bed in your body. So when I say localized, intrinsic mechanism, autoregulatory, it basically happens on its own without conscious input by your brain, basically. Imagine you have a system of tubes to represent blood vessels. Let's say you have one blood vessel that's supplying blood to some capillary bed. I'll just draw a capillary bed like that. And what kind of drives blood flow to the capillary bed, because it's supplying blood to some cells, draw some cells there, you gotta make sure that the cells, you know, get enough oxygen. And it kind of self-regulates. If you've got plenty of oxygen, maybe you can vasoconstrict a little bit. Remember, when you vasoconstrict at that one location, you're decreasing little r, the radius, you're increasing capital R, right? Therefore, at this particular point, you're decreasing blood flow. Because you've got enough oxygen for now, but But let's say now the cells start to become hypoxic. Lack of blood flow, lack of oxygen. You'd simply want to reverse it. So you'd simply want to vasodilate to increase the radius, therefore decrease the resistance, the blood flow, and increase the flow to restore enough blood flow to correct the hypoxia. And this happens just by itself. Okay? I think books usually list a bunch of different molecules that constrict or dilate vessels, and I think I just want you to know the one that I mentioned before. Do you remember it? When I talked about erectile dysfunction. Nitric oxide. That's the one. Nitric oxide used to be called endothelial-derived factor. They didn't know what it was. They knew it was there, and dilated stuff. But now we know it's nitric oxide, and we can control its release with drugs. That's great, right? We always hear about it with Viagra or other erectile dysfunction drugs. Nitric oxide is a huge risk factor for heart disease if the levels are low, because you're worried about the coronary arteries closing up. All right, so anyways, that's the one molecule I think is important. So anyways, this is happening locally all the time, but let's talk about a systemic response that's widespread. Extrinsic sympathetic. What I had mentioned earlier is the cold pressure test. That's a good example of that. Whenever you see the word pressor in physiology, it means increase in pressure. Okay. So that example, I'll draw a couple of your blood vessels. My system of tubes. Well, anyways, so your subject is in a painful situation, the cold pressure test. They're in pain. The pain elicits this response. When you have a painful stimulus, you constrict the arterioles. I'll put VC arterioles. You constrict other things too. For now, I'll just keep it to the arterioles. So you constrict at this location. You constrict in most locations. There's a large group of arterioles you constrict. This happens best at the GI tract and the liver. There's a lot of blood that goes there, and you constrict blood flow to that. GI, liver. So you're restricting blood flow to these locations that you don't really need for a sympathetic response. So it's like you're increasing resistance. You're keeping more blood in the arteries. Blood tries to go here and it really can't. Blood tries to go here, it really can't. You keep more blood in arteries, and when you measure blood pressure, you should see an increase. What you're doing is you vasoconstrict a large area and you vasodilate a smaller area. These are going to the muscles. So I'll just kind of draw.
Vasoconstrict large areas?
Yeah. So vasoconstrict, call this large, and then here, vasodilate a smaller set of arterioles. This is going to muscles, okay? To muscles. Makes sense, right? You're shunting the blood to the muscles because, you know, that's what you need for a sympathetic response, to increase metabolic strength. All right, so that's it. It's called widespread because it's like happening basically all over the place. It's called extrinsic because you need sympathetic nerves to fire. One set will fire in a way where you constrict, the other one fires in a way where you dilate. So any questions on the arteriolar stuff, constrict, dilate, whether it's locally or systemically? This is an important one.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so the localized and transit.
Yeah.
Okay, so that one is going to, that one is going to lower blood pressure, right?
No. You're not going to observe a systemic change in blood pressure locally, because it's only happening in these small little areas.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You would observe a change in blood pressure in a person if it's happening systemically, the whole system's being affected. So that's why I put this picture here. You're just shutting one capillary bed off or on. Just one location, very small, minute. But here, I put this whole picture, it's happening everywhere, okay? So that's why when we do it in lab, you should see a change in the person's whole blood pressure. All right, I'll move on here. Students show me their hands after they do it. Man, look at my hand, it's all like bright red, and it is painful, so brace yourself, and yeah. Okay. Do I have any athletes in the room? Anyone ever been asked by a trainer to get in a whole tub of ice? I've heard that that's extremely unbearable, but I don't know, it helps athletes in the training room. But we're just doing the hand. It still elicits a very painful response. Okay, sympathetic input into arterioles elicits a vasoconstrictive response very well at the GI and liver. Okay, I just wrote that. And there's sympathetic inputs to the working muscle beds that has a vasodilator response. So you constrict one area, you dilate the other. But you should see an overall jump in BP. Okay, now I want to talk about the sympathetic response to the veins. I didn't really mention that over there. It's just too much to talk about in one spot. But let's talk about the sympathetic response and how it affects the veins. It affects it in a different way. Let me go over here. Sympathetic response is different for veins compared to arteries. So for the arterioles, what we just got through saying, just to review real quick, imagine you have a tube, I'll just kind of draw like that. And when you constrict the arteriole, those precapillary sphincters or whatever, you constrict by more or less like that. You kind of constrict at one location. Say blood is trying to flow this way. You increase the resistance to blood flow. So what we say is when you vasoconstrict, VC, you decrease little r, right? You increase big R, and that helps to increase the blood pressure. Now it's different for veins, right? This has the effect of decreasing the outflow. You're keeping more blood in the arteries to raise blood pressure in a sympathetic response. That's good, okay? So, but for veins, now veins are on the other side. So for veins, what happens is, since for arteries, are arterioles, I should say, they're for veins. Venules, or small veins. You take the tube and you just kind of shrink it just a little bit, the whole tube, across a larger area. And just kind of go like that. This super small constriction, but over a large area. A small constriction. But over a large cross-sectional area. I'll just say over a larger area. So instead of squeezing at one point, you just take the whole tube and shrink the caliper a little bit. Okay? Now the effect this has is different. Right? So you are vasoconstricting, I'll put that. You are vasoconstricting, I'll put VC. And you are changing radius. Okay, but not very much, right? It's just a smaller change over a larger area, change in radius. You're not squeezing really tight in one location like this. And in doing that, you're not really affecting radius. There's no effect on resistance. No effect on capital R. Because you're not changing it that much. But what this does do is you're taking the capacity and you're shrinking the whole system. So you affect capacitance more than resistance. So what this really does, this little change in R, no effect on big R, you decrease the venous capacitance. No change on resistance. You're going to increase venous pressures. Increase, here's the key, increase venous return. So that's the thinking you got to keep straight in your head. This is a sympathetic response. Most of your blood is in the blood reservoir. You want to get the blood out of the veins on the artery side in a sympathetic response. So you have to mobilize it. So what you want to do is, while the blood is over here, shrink the container, because when you do that, you force it one way. Where? I can only go back to the heart. I'm not going to go reverse. Okay. So by shrinking this whole container, you increase the venous return. You don't really affect the resistance, you affect the capacitance much more. Now, I remember talking about this, I was confused, and I went to the office hoppers, Jack Goldberg's office. I was like, I went through the whole thing. I said, you said you decrease the radius, but you don't increase the resistance? I'm confused. And he gave me the same analogy. Like imagine if you had a garden hose, and you turn the garden hose on, and you just almost shut it at one part. The water wouldn't drip out very much. But what if you took the whole garden hose and just shrunk it a little bit? Would the water stop flowing? No, in fact, you'd probably increase the water pressure. Okay, and I was like, oh, okay, yeah, you're right. You're hoping this had the same effect on you, Basically, that's why I call this mobilization of the blood reservoir. you increase the venous return. The story doesn't stop there. You know Frank Starling. More in, more out. So this will effectively increase cardiac output, and that's pretty much the net effect of that. Increase CO, cardiac output. So to go back to this picture here, in a sympathetic response, you are decreasing the outflow and increasing the inflow. Or at the very bottom, increase in flow. So that's kind of what I tried to draw in here. I just took this whole big tube and I just kind of shrunk it a little bit. That way you increase the venous return. So all that's happening, and one of the equations in tomorrow's lab is this one. Now, blood pressure is a function of the cardiac output and the resistance. So again, to kind of program your brain, basically the stuff on the right determines blood pressure. It's not vice versa, okay? And we know that cardiac output is a product of heart rate and stroke volume. So these parameters change to change cardiac output, which changes blood pressure. And the same thing with R or PR. I usually just use capital R. But now we know that lowercase r, vessel radius, means constrict or dilate the blood vessel. And that can also alter blood pressure. So basically, number one and number two determine number three. Now, for venous pressures, we spend most of the time talking about arterial pressures. I do want to mention three things that are considered modifications to help the venous return. Because under normal resting conditions, pressure in veins isn't enough to do it. Okay, because there's very low pressures in veins. So what is the driving force that helps blood get back to the heart if there's not a lot of pressure there? So what I'm writing is veins have low pressures. They basically, need help, to try to accomplish venous return. How can they accomplish venous return? That's their job. Their only job is venous return. They got to return blood to the heart. So large lumens, venous valves, and a couple of venous pumps. Remember, they're too far away from the heart pump, so they need other pumps. If you have a large lumen, that helps because you have less resistance to blood flow. So that's a modification. Large lumens of veins help reduce capital R resistance. So that's good. The venous valves are very effective. Remember, arteries don't have valves. They only have the aortic valve right at the heart. After that, there's no valves in arteries. But throughout the length of veins, there's valves. Shown here, this is why venous valves are effective. I'm writing venous valves prevent backwards flow of blood. So pretend you're standing upright. You can see that on C, right? against the force of gravity. It's like, well, you close all the valves so blood isn't flowing backwards. Think of each of these as a compartment with valves on either side. Now, this isn't doing the job, is it? This is not venous return, but at least you've prevented backwards flow of blood. So look what you gotta do. If you did this and you had no valves and you squeezed, you would squeeze the fluid in both directions. That's not helping us very well because you're squeezing half the blood back down towards the foot. Okay? This is the best scenario, but when you squeeze, the valve closes here, but then you push blood up. Okay. So this is called the skeletal muscle pump. This is the pump because the heart isn't doing anything. So I'll say in conjunction with the skeletal muscle pump. You help accomplish venous return. That's the pump, just your muscles moving. So, you know, walking around, if you've been sitting for a long time, I should give you a break soon, so you can improve your circulation. So here they show an actual leg, right? And calf muscle squeezing veins to help accomplish the venous return. That's one pump. There's another pump here, and I like this picture. They show her laying down. So you're laying down. Which pressure do you eliminate when you're horizontal? The force against gravity, hydrostatic pressure. So laying horizontal, it's relaxing, and you also eliminate hydrostatic pressure. When you breathe, and we'll get to this in respiratory, take a breath in. What happens to your chest cavity? Does it expand or collapse? It expands. When you increase the volume, you decrease the pressure in there. That decrease in pressure, well, it says it here, 5 millimeters mercury less atmospheric pressure. Here is atmospheric pressure. So you create a pump, basically, by creating this little bit of a pressure gradient, 5 millimeters less. Because of the respiratory activity in the chest cavity, pressure surrounding chest veins is lower than pressure surrounding veins in the abdomen and extremities. This establishes a pressure gradient that drives blood towards the heart. And so this helps because it's not much of a gradient. It helps if you're lying down. Respiratory pump. Create negative pressure. In chest veins. While breathing. What I have here, or I don't mean to teach from this, but I wanted to like list a bunch of practice questions that you can kind of look at on your own in your own study and just kind of drill each other, ask me if you're confused about any of the points. So just take a look through all the slides. What I want to do now is take a break, and we'll come back, and I want to start the anatomy of the blood vessels. Come back in about 20 minutes.